Grace, mercy, and peace be with you in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus the Christ. Last week, I had a conversation with my cousin, Tyler, who was interviewing for a coaching position at a Christian school. He said that rather than starting the interview questions, or rather than starting the interview with questions about stats or plays, instead they asked him to share his faith story. Now, that's not your average interview question, so I had to ask, well, what did you say? And without hesitation, Tyler told me, I told them about my mom. I told them how faithful and loving and generous she was, and how she instilled those values, that faith, in me. And I wonder how many of our faith stories start exactly that same way, with our moms, or our dads, or our grandmothers, or our grandfathers, with a neighbor, or a coach, or a friend, with someone who showed us by their life what it means to be a follower of Jesus. How many of us had our faith kindled by someone else who was faithful and loving and generous, and who passed that kind of faith on to us? Sometimes they did it intentionally, and sometimes it happened merely by osmosis. Just by being around that kind of person, faith can be infectious. I thank God for those people in our lives. Our first reading this morning is a story about one such person. She's a woman who has two names, Tabitha in Aramaic and Dorcas in Greek. Our text says that she was a disciple of Jesus who lived in the coastal city of Joppa. Dorcas was a beloved member of the Christian community. She used her skills with textiles to make clothing for other people, especially for widows who were among the most vulnerable in that community. In this story, Dorcas becomes ill and she dies, and the entire community is grieved by that loss. So much so that they send for Peter, who's working in a nearby town. And when Peter arrives, he finds the body of Dorcas in an upper room, surrounded by loved ones. The widows that she has cared for, who she made clothing for, they're clinging to the clothes that Dorcas made and trying to show them to Peter, remembering this faithful and loving and generous woman that they lost. Peter had been present when Jesus raised Jairus' daughter from the dead, and so now he's going to follow in the footsteps of his master. So he sends everyone out of the room, and then he kneels down to pray. And then Peter says to the woman, Tabitha, get up. And she does. Dorcas lives on to make more clothes and to care for more widows and to share her faith with more members of the community. It's a really beautiful story. As you know, I mentioned earlier that I'm just back from a visit to the Holy Land, and I promise that I am not going to be one of those pastors that starts every sermon or every sentence with, when I was in the Holy Land. But if you'll indulge me just this once, when I was in the Holy Land, I saw something that made quite an impression on me. It wasn't a church or an ancient ruin. It was a truck, a pickup truck. But I'll tell you more about that in a minute. Here at Well of Hope, we use the Western Christian calendar. But Orthodox traditions use a different calendar, the Orthodox calendar or the Eastern Christian calendar. And for them, Easter happens a week later, which means that I was in the Holy Land for the Orthodox Holy Week and for their Easter celebration. There's an ancient tradition in the church, across all expressions of the church, that involves lighting a fire on Holy Saturday during the Easter Vigil. It's called the Rite of New Fire, or Holy Fire, and it symbolizes the resurrection of Jesus and the light of Christ returning to the world. The New Fire is usually used to light a special candle called the Christ Candle, or the Paschal Candle, which burns throughout the season of Easter. When the Christ Candle is lit in our tradition, the presiding minister says, may the light of Christ rising in glory dispel the darkness of our hearts and minds. It's a cool liturgy. And there's this church in Jerusalem called the Church of the Holy Sepulchre that marks the place of Jesus' death and burial, and therefore his resurrection. And on Easter Vigil, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre is packed with Christians who are there to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. During the celebration, the patriarch of the Greek Orthodox Church enters the tomb, and then moments later returns with holy fire. And he immediately passes that flame on to someone else, who passes it to another person, who passes it to another person, kind of like we do during Christmas Eve when we sing Silent Night. Within minutes, the entire church is filled with people holding this holy fire. And then people run outside of the church building and they pass the flame on to other people who are waiting outside. And those people take the flame back with them to their own churches and their own communities. I didn't really know about this tradition until our tour bus got stuck in a traffic jam in Bethlehem. And all of a sudden there was this commotion in the street and there was yelling and honking and cheering. And when I looked out the window, I saw this pickup truck that was at the center of all of the fuss. It was decorated with red streamers and flowers and big red crosses. It could have been afloat in the Rose Bowl parade. And there were people hanging off the sides of this pickup truck, and they were waving at the crowds like they were in some kind of like Super Bowl parade. And there was one person in the bed of the truck who was holding this big torch. And the torch had a flame on it that came from the fire, the holy fire, that was in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. When we asked our guide what was happening, he said, "They are bringing the light of our Lord Jesus Christ back to their churches, where the people are waiting to receive it." I thought that was so cool. This idea of a light, of holy fire busting out of the tomb and spreading through the people in the church and spreading through the city and making its way to every congregation in the Holy Land. Kind of reminds me of Tyler's mom and of Dorcas. It reminds me of the way that people pass faith on to other people. The way that we share the light and love of our Lord Jesus Christ with each other and with the world. In our first lesson this morning, Peter brings Dorcas back to life, and that's great. It's a beautiful story. It's a beautiful miracle. But even that second life that she got, it didn't last. Our bodies are temporal. They are fragile. They will fail. And we know that all too well. But the love of God is eternal, and it will not be extinguished, ever. Not by sin, not by darkness, not even by death. And as followers of Jesus, we get to be the ones who pass the flame of faith on to other people. We get to be the ones who share the love of God with the next person and the next, through each loving act and through each mercy. Our witness will outlive us, to be sure. Tyler's mom died when he was 18. And now 14 years later, how does he start his faith story? I told them about my mom. And here, more than 2,000 years after Dorcas' death, we're still talking about her and telling her faith story and teaching our children about what it means to be someone like Dorcas. The faith of our mothers and our grandmothers, of our fathers and our grandfathers, the faith of loved ones departed will continue to burn bright in each one of us. Because the love of God is eternal and will not be extinguished, not even by death. So may we be those people in the world, those moms and dads and friends and neighbors. May we be the ones who share the light and love of Christ with others through word and deed. May we carry that spark of faith, that light that shines in the darkness, that sign of God's enduring and unending love. May we share it with all the world, one person at a time. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen.